1907 when the women of Iceland went on strike on October 24th, 1975. They marched into the center of Reykjavik and filled the streets. 90% of women did no work that day. No schools opened, no banks opened, no kids ate, no buses rode into town. It was impossible to get anything done on that day because when women don't work, nothing works. They changed the impression of the value of women for women and men alike forever because nothing worked in Iceland that day. So they changed the very reality that I grew up with, and they changed my view on it forever. And 5 years after this day, we were the first country to democratically elect a female president. She was a single mom. She had a 7-year-old daughter. You cannot help but to think those role models and these women who came before us and think that we owe it to the next generation to empower ourselves and the generations that follow.
I campaigned all over the country, and it was absolutely a unique experience. I never slept in a hotel. I slept in children's beds around the country, and it was arranged. They knew who in the area would vote for me, and I campaigned, and finally, I was elected. There were hundreds of people outside the house here. My daughter, 7 years old, was standing beside me.
You know, if you take the really long view of history, you have essentially a few thousand years of it being just one way. Men in charge, men in control, men making the decisions, calling the shots, politically, economically, socially, and personally. Look what's happened in this time since that women's strike in 75, since your election in 1980. How many countries have elected women? I mean, dozens. And that doesn't even count the women elected by parliaments.
All fathers know that the daughter is as clever as the boy, has the same intelligence. All brothers know that the sisters have the same intelligence as they have. I'm very proud that Iceland was the first and set an example.
Right.
And definitely it had a very good effect on our women and girls here at home.
That's okay. Exactly how I would have hit it.
That center.
I predict an eagle for this hole.
Okay. Meet Hafdis, Rangvig, and Margaret. Aside from beating me in a game of golf on a balmy 29-degree day, these women are all CEOs, one of them the former head of their Food and Drug Administration. They're part of a generation of Icelandic women, inspired by the election of President Vigdís.
I think Iceland is the best country to be a female in the world.
There has been a lot of changes the last maybe
15 to 20 years.
Yeah.
And we've gone like that.
Yeah.
We have the same chance as the men.
You do?
Yeah. Definitely.
You feel that in your bones.
Yes, in your bones. We grow up believing that. I mean, we don't even think about it.
We have a gender quota for the biggest companies.
Yeah. You mean the company's board of directors?
Yeah. So you have to be either 40%, at least 40% women or 40% men. Because you also have to think about the young men. They need to get on the boards also. So it's a good law for them also.
Right. Yeah. So it can't be more than 60% women.
Yeah.
No.
That's true. Yeah.
Research has shown us that, and this is international research, that once you have three women in the boardroom, that's when culture starts changing. Not when you have one or two, because one is a token and two is a minority. But once you have three, it all of a sudden changes the group dynamics. It changes how the dialogue is taken, what is discussed. And it's been well shown that that goes beyond the balance sheet when you have more women around the table. They start asking more about all stakeholders. And this is what I call a different moral and ethical compass. And I think this is extremely valuable today. And I actually don't think you can survive long term in business without doing this today.
Throughout my invasions, it was clear that where women had power and were true equals,
people were simply better off. Yet here in Iceland, I felt that the women had taken this to an even higher level. And while they controlled nearly half the seats on company boards and nearly half the seats in parliament, it did make me wonder, what was it that the men of Iceland still controlled?
When much of the world went into recession last year, no country melted down faster than Iceland, dragging down three major banks with it. The only bank to operate in the black is run by women. So, does gender make a difference in the financial world? Here's Sheila McVicker.
Iceland's collapse was the fastest in history, with 85% of the economy wiped out in weeks. There was only one financial institution, Outer Capital in Iceland, that did not lose money for its customers. Founded by two women on the investment principle of, if we don't understand it, we're not buying it. There's a lot of talk here about the difference it would have made if more women were on the trading floors.
It's been 99% men that wanted to take risk, wanted speed, wanted individual rewards and excessive rewards.
There's new evidence emerging that some of what happens on trading floors may be partly the result of male hormones. When testosterone levels get too high, traders become overconfident, take too much risk, and the bubble bursts.
Women, they think, what's good for the whole? Where men, more, they think, what's in it for me?
It's a provocative question being debated around the globe. Where would we be if it had been Lehman Sisters?
So do you think any of this would have happened if women had been in charge in 2008?
I thought we had created a world that was on an empty pursuit for more. And I had a question about if this growth journey we had been on was really a successful business strategy that I had somehow missed during my MBA education. Is it a relentless pursuit for getting big, or is this the great big penis competition?
So 20, 30 persons in Iceland, yes, have turned the whole economy on this island on its head?
Yes.
20, 30 persons?
Yes.
That's insane.
Yes, that is.
Normally stoic and proper Icelanders have started protesting.
Já, ég er að bjóða mig fram í fyrsta sæti í besta flokksins í Reykjavík. Ég held að ég hafi mjög góðan bakgrunn til að starfa í þessu starfi. Ég vann árabil á geðdeild, er næstum því með pungapróf og ég með meira próf.
His name was Jón Gnarr, and he's Iceland's top comedian. He decided to run for mayor of its capital city, Reykjavík, as a joke. The people of Reykjavík thought it was the best way to send a message to the bankers and the people who had ruined their country.
So why did you decide to call it the best party?
Well, because there's this idea of best. Here we're not allowed to say that something is best.
I mean, it's not against the law, you mean Icelandic culture?
Yeah, it's a law.
What is the law?
I cannot say that this brand of coffee is the best brand of coffee.
Oh, really?
No, you cannot say it, you know.
Have you tried it?
Yeah, it's very good, but it's not the best. It's the best, but I can't say it.
It might be the, okay.
No, but they don't have these rules in politics.
He won in a landslide. His election was a total rebuke of these guys. The bankers.
Anybody who has kids will know that if the kids get away with their crime, chances are they will continue.
When the bankers went to court, they went to a real criminal court, and when the judges issued the sentence, they put the bankers away. Far away. Far, 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 really far away. They were being kept as far away from society as possible, where they could do no harm to the people of Iceland. That's not exactly how we did it. Well, There was that one guy named Kareem. But since the crash of 08, not a single banker without a Muslim name has been tried in a criminal court in the United States of America. In Iceland, nearly 70 bankers and hedge fund managers were prosecuted, with many of them sent to prison. I went to see the top cop, the special prosecutor appointed to put the bankers in prison. His name was Ólafur Thor Hauksson. The bankers know him as Thor.
So Thor, I have the files here actually of the people that I think helped precipitate the banking collapse in the United States.
Okay.
Just take a look at that in your spare time here if you can. If you read through these files, you'll see things that will make even Icelandic hair stand up on end.
Okay.
I mean, it's...
Can I keep this?
You can, actually. Yep, I wish you would, yes.
Actually, you know, in the States, you have the ability and the knowledge to do the right thing.
Yes.
In America, you had a prior incident. You had the saving and loan scandal.
Mm-hmm.
You had some prosecutions at that time.
We did.
Yeah.
That's right, and people went to jail.
So you have one of the prosecutors that actually worked on that. He gave us an advice.
So our prosecutor, one of them, gave advice to your office to help you do this.
Yeah. Jack Black.
Jack Black?
No, not Jack Black, it was Bill Black, I think, the former prosecutor in the U.S. He was quite blunt with us, and we learned a lot from him.
Well, Thor, I have invaded Iceland because you decided to investigate and prosecute your bankers after your banking collapse and put a number of them in prison. And that's just a genius idea I want to take back to the United States.
Okay.
You're the man. Thank you for this great idea.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Because Iceland didn't bail out their banks and instead prosecuted the bankers and turned much of the financial decision-making over to the women, their economy has completely recovered. In fact, it's doing better than ever.
Why do you think the United States is like this? Why don't we have what you have?
In America, you have the American dream, that you have, it's a land of opportunities, that everybody will be able to do whatever. But in reality, it isn't like that. Every kid should have the same opportunity, the basic opportunity to get education and healthcare. It's not communism, it's just a good society.
Mm-hmm.
You play more solo. I'm taking care of myself and my family, and the rest I don't care about. But we are more like a big group, and we try to take care of each other within that group.
Right. You structure yourself with we in mind, and we structure ourselves with me in mind.
It's the women.
More women. Mm-hmm.
It's women, right?
It's our DNA, yeah.
I'm convinced. It's my conviction. That's my belief in women. A capacity and the intelligence of women. If the world can be saved, it will be women that do that. And they do not do it with war. They do it with words. Women, if they are running society, they are looking for peace. They want to save humanity. They want to save their children. When the men on earth open up to a woman see things and add it to their way of seeing things, then we get a better world.
if you were to talk to Americans, if you had 2 minutes to say anything you wanted to the American people, what would you say? And don't be afraid of hurting our feelings.
No.
We need some truth here.
Yeah. I wouldn't want to live in the States even though you paid me, because just the society and the way that you treat people, the way that you treat your neighbors, I would never want to be your neighbor. Never, ever. Because you don't treat your fellow Americans the way you should. How can you, in a way, come home and feel well if you know there are so many people that can't eat, they're sick, they can't go to the doctors, they can't get any education? How can you come home and feel okay with that? I couldn't.
I don't feel okay about it.
No, that's good. You shouldn't feel okay with that.